Welcome to Valley Grove Baptist Church, located at 1731 South, U.S. Highway 281 in Stephenville, Texas. We are glad you joined us for our 10:30 Sunday morning worship service. If you'd like to learn more about Valley Grove, please check us out at our website at valleygrove.net. Now, join us for the morning worship service already in progress.
Today we celebrate the way God's promise of a Savior came true in the birth of a baby named Jesus. For Jesus is God's gift to us, the best gift ever, better than anything we could ever ask for or even know. As we celebrate, we remember the focus of Advent in these past four Sundays. We remember the hope that God gives humanity and how the prophet Isaiah invited the people to walk in the light of the Lord, to live out their faith in every area of life. We give thanks to God for the peace He gives us now, and we look forward to the peaceful kingdom to come with Christ's return. We remember the promises of God who brings us true joy. And like Mary and Joseph, we listen to God and demonstrate our love for Him by doing what He asks us to do, even when it's hard. In remembrance of these gifts, and certainly the gift of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, let's join the prayer together. Gracious Father, we have remembered and celebrated this season of Advent, remembering Christ's first coming to earth, and celebrating the great anticipation of His second. Father, all with our eyes firmly fixed. And today, as we celebrate the love demonstrated to us in the Christmas story, Father, we do so again with our eyes firmly fixed on You. Lord, come and inhabit this place. Sit with us in the pews. Teach us, guide us, encourage us, challenge us, and draw us near. Father, may we learn from You today. May we seek You today. And Father, may all that we say and do here today bring honor and glory to You, God Almighty, Jesus Christ, King of kings and Lord of lords. It's in His name we pray. Amen. Our waiting is over, so let us celebrate the day of our Savior's birth.
Let's stand together and let's sing Joy to the World. Let's sing it with joy in our hearts this morning. Joy to the World.
Morning. let me apologize because this isn't really the time that we want to do this. But when you have a feeble memory like mine, you got to pay the price sometimes. And we were supposed to vote on the budget last week. And I just blew right past it. Never thought about it until Mike texted me that afternoon. We go, oh, yeah. Thought about it beforehand, never again. So we moved it up to the service so we wouldn't forget this time. So we're going to enter very quickly in a special call business meeting, sole purpose of voting on the 2018 budget. My apologies for doing it now. We got to do it. Okay? So, it comes as a form of a motion in a second because it comes from a standing committee. All those in favor of it say amen.
Amen.
Any opposed say aye. And the amens have it and the budget passes. And we'll dismiss the day. So, visitors, my apologies. Thank you for being here today. I know that many of you have come in to be with loved ones and family. I'm glad that you're here today. Special service. Always look forward to this time, and it's certainly going to be a blessed time. You'll see that we have candles lit over here, but not all of them. These candles represent our goal for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, which is our in-gathering for supporting foreign missionaries. And so we are getting close to our $5,000 goal. We're not quite there, so the Lord lays that on your heart. Please, please listen and give as we can to support our foreign missionaries. It's certainly a wonderful time of the year to do just that. One of the great things about Christmas time is getting to catch up and visit. You don't get to have that much time, but you can shake a few hands. So let's stand and greet one another in the love of Christ. Glad to be here.
Angels, sing in exultation.
those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the whole entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Cornelius Cornelius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to rest. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Jerusalem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the
field. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all of you. Today in the town of David, Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests."
When the angels had left them and had gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see the things that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about the child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. So as we just heard that last part there, the shepherds went back glorifying God. You know, that's what we need to do today as well, is we need to go out into the world and tell people about who Jesus is. So let's pray. Father, I do thank you so much that you sent your son, Jesus, as a roommate, humbly before us, Father, that a helpless babe, that we now get to rely on you to be that Savior in our lives. Father, I just thank you so much for each of these little ones and for the love that they have for you. And I just ask that they would just continue to follow you and to love you. Father, just be with them and their families and just let them have just a wonderful time together as a family to celebrate Christmas and the love that you have for each one of us. And we just ask all these things from such a living.
Oh, was about Christ our Savior. But Lord, that song is more personal to us because you died for us. And the angels, they don't understand that because they have not what we have. Lord, we have a risen Savior today to praise, and we thank you for that. Lord, it's my prayer that each person in this building knows that. Lord, if there's not that assurance in their heart about what this true meaning of Christmas is, Lord, I pray that today, before they walk out these doors, they will know the true meaning of Christmas, that you came so that we can have eternal life and forgiveness of our sins, and we thank you for that today. And Lord, we look forward to that one day when we will join the angels personally around the throne and sing praises to you. Father, I pray that we will do just as Mark said, we will take that message out to those around us and tell people about you. Lord, we thank you for those who are here. Thank you for family and friends and guests who are here. May they feel welcome in this place. Lord, I pray for our pastor. Be with him as he brings the word of God. May you speak to him. May you bless this offering. I pray that you bless the gift and the giver. We love you, Lord Jesus, today. Thank you for all that you've done. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
For the same level of completeness we see at work in the story of Christmas. We remember that Joseph and Mary were traveling to Bethlehem because of the census commands of Caesar. Joseph and Mary were actually both descendants of King David, and they were traveling there to register in their home district because of Joseph. They fulfilled the various promises of Jesus being of David's lineage and being born in Bethlehem, Micah 5:2 states, "But you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from the ancient of days." And so the little town of Bethlehem will play a large role in the story of Christmas. But did you know what Bethlehem means? The name Bethlehem actually means house of bread. Isn't it beautiful that Jesus, the bread of life, born in a city called the House of Bread? Part of my study this week led me to a Jewish scholar teaching about the shepherds. Shepherding was one of the humblest of occupations. It was the lower level position, both in jobs were concerned, but also in society. But God chose these humble servants to be the first to hear the joyous news. Ones that many in society would overlook would hear the proclamation from God about his son's birth. It brings to mind Jesus' resurrection. At that time, God also chose one that many in those days would overlook. He chose Mary Magdalene to be the first to hear the good news, that Christ was risen and was alive. God certainly has a soft spot in his heart for the less fortunate, the downtrodden, the vulnerable, the overlooked. And he calls on us as his followers to do the same. It's part of the completeness. Society might have said that the news of Jesus' birth wasn't worth being told to the lower levels of society. God said, "That's the ones I'm telling first. Because I want the whole world, the complete world, to hear." Many scholars also believe that the shepherds were Levitical shepherds. This meant that the flocks that they cared for would be the ones responsible for providing their lambs for the Passover sacrifice. Because of this, the shepherds would often take the ewes that were ready to give birth, and they would take them to their stables, which are actually dugouts or caves in the area. And in these birthing caves, the shepherds would await the arrival of those Passover lambs. I find it interesting that God likely chose one of these birthing caves of the shepherds to serve as the birthplace of Jesus Christ. So the Lamb of God, very likely born in the cave where Passover lambs were born. Furthermore, it was a common practice for the Levitical shepherds to take strips of cloth and wrap around the legs and bodies of those little lambs, because remember, they were to be unblemished sacrifices for the Passover altar. So what must the shepherds have thought when the angels led them to the caves where the Lamb of God was born? They found him swaddled in strips of cloth. I wonder if they had the understanding that here was the unblemished Lamb of God, whose son 33 years later would, at Passover celebration, become the perfect sacrifice to take away the sin of the world. It would be too much to expect anyone to understand the completeness of God's foreshadowing that night, but perhaps those shepherds understood better than many. God certainly did his part in the specialness and in the uniqueness of the announcements. Angels are mentioned nearly 300 times in the Old and New Testaments. Their appearance generally always indicated a specialness to the events that were transpiring. And the Christmas story is no different. The Christmas story is saturated with angelic activity. In the first chapter of Luke, we read the story of the angel Gabriel appearing to Zacharias, the father of John the Baptist. The angel advised him that his wife Elizabeth would bear him a son. He would be the forerunner to the coming Messiah. Gabriel will appear again Luke chapter 1, the most important appearance. He appears to the Virgin Mary with an important message, not only for her, but for all mankind. He speaks to her with some of the most wonderful words written in the Bible from God to Mary. Can you imagine hearing these words as a young teenage girl? Fear not, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you shall conceive in your womb and bring forth the Son, and you shall call him Jesus. And he shall reign in the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom, of his kingdom, there shall be no end. First chapter of Matthew, an angel appeared to Joseph, telling him, assuring him that Mary was with child, but through God, and not through another man. The second chapter of Luke, God sent his heavenly messenger to deliver the great news to the shepherds in the field nearby Bethlehem, that the Messiah, who had been long prophesied about in the Old Testament, had been born. For behold, they said, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Bookending in Jesus' life is the appearance of the angel at his tomb, rolled away the large stone and announced that Jesus Christ was certainly risen. All of this activity and specialness of God brought to mind this week the sixth chapter of 2 Kings. There it speaks of some of the activities of the prophet Elisha. Elisha, who came after Elijah, was a great prophet, a great man of God, and in just some of the activities in that chapter just seem to recall to me the activity of Christmas. Elisha was meeting some men. He was striving to get away from the enemy king, and they were building new places in which to live, and one young man had lost the axe head in the river. He was greatly distraught because the axe head was borrowed. It was a signal that he was a poor man, not able to afford an axe of his own. Prophet touched the river and the axe head floated. You know, God has always had that special place with the ones that have those difficult journeys in life. God doesn't forget any of them. But they went on and they built lodging there in the promised land, and Elisha, he was sought after by the enemy king because he would give guidance and instruction and wisdom to the king of Israel. So the enemy king sought him out, and so he surrounded the city with his chariots and with his army and with his horses. The young servant of Elisha's went out and was greatly distraught. He looked around and saw that their camp was encircled by the enemy. I love Elisha's words. He says, don't worry. Paraphrasing, he said it this way, don't worry. Our army is bigger than theirs. You see, Elisha could see the activities that most couldn't. And so he prayed to God that the servant's eyes would be open to see. And when he did, the servant could look out into the mountainside and see an army of chariots of fire, much greater than the enemy army. It's a beautiful testimony for God. What God was showing the young man was this. It wasn't about what mankind could accomplish, but what God and God alone could accomplish. Psalm 146, verses 3 through 5 puts it this way. Don't put your trust in princes or in mortal man who cannot save. For their spirit departs when they return to the ground, and on that very day their plans come to nothing. But blessed is he whose hope is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, the Lord who remains faithful forever. See, that's the story of Christmas. That's the story of Christ. It's not what man can accomplish. It's not what you and I can accomplish. It's what God and God alone can accomplish. So the story of Christ is God accomplishing what he alone can accomplish. That the Lamb of God, who would take away the sin of the world, was born. Knowing full well that what lay ahead of him was a cross. children. It says your attitude should be that of Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above all names, that at that name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Today we celebrate what God and God alone could accomplish, because of his love for us. We can celebrate it because of the hope that is offered to us through the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. And so on this day of celebrating his birth, we also remember the sacrifice on the cross by celebrating the Lord's Supper today. Brother Rob and Jeremy are going to come and lead us in a song of contemplation, and in doing so, let us prepare our hearts to celebrate his sacrifice today.
The word hallelujah means to you really a shout or praise to the Lord. And we're going to sing a song that summarizes the Christmas story. And the steps that it took to get there should make us shout and sing hallelujah and praise the Lord. And so we're going to ask you to sing the chorus with us together and the last verse with us as well. So we'll sing the first, the chorus first.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. A couple came to Bethlehem, expecting child, they searched the air to find a place where you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born.
Hallelujah.
rescue me. This baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew was hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.